This week on our desert island is the actor Michael York. Michael, you must live a pretty gregarious life in the theater and on film sets. Could you take solitude?
A certain amount of it, I think, yes, I would. I'd love to.
You could adjust.
Yes, I was a loner, very much a loner as a child, and I enjoyed being alone. But since I got married, I haven't been alone. I don't know whether I could really readapt to it.
How much does music mean to you?
A lot.
Have you any skill? Do you play an instrument?
I have memories of playing the violin at the age of 11 or 9 in the school orchestra.
Really?
And playing the piano, but it never went further than that.
Hmm.
I just love playing the gramophone.
Do you collect discs?
Up to a point. Discs and tapes. I very much listen to the radio, so that, you know, whatever God bestows, I pick up.
How long did it take you to make out your list for the desert island? Did you make a long list and then cross them out, or did you just write down 8 as they came to you?
I thought that unless I did it off the top of my head, almost subconsciously, I'd never turn up with a list at all. So it took me, I think, a minute.
Well, you've changed your mind about several of them in the last half hour.
Yes, I know. And if we hadn't had this deadline, this broadcasting deadline, I probably would have completely changed it all over again. But
what's the first one?
Well, I thought something to make us all wake up. It's Wagner. It's the funeral music from Götterdämmerung.
This sounds a little somber for a situation like a desert island.
I find that Wagner gets me going. He energizes me. In fact, this is the piece of music I was once playing in Bent on Broadway. Before going on, I put it on in my dressing room. And to the sounds of these enormous noises, these energizing, thrilling noises, I'd rush on stage and do my stuff. It seemed to work then.
I hope it works on a
desert
island.
On a desert island, yes.
Siegfried's Funeral March from Götterdämmerung, the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Herbert von Karajan. You were born in Buckinghamshire, Michael, but you moved about.
Yes, good training for an actor. I was born, in fact, in a manor house in Fulmer, in Buckinghamshire, which during the war had been turned into a nursing home for the wives of impecunious officers. But then I lived my early childhood in an Oxfordshire village near the Cotswolds.
Yes.
Then I lived near London, then I lived near Brighton. Then again in the suburbs of London again. So, as I said, it was the beginning of a peripatetic lifestyle that's stayed with me ever since.
So this meant different schools, of course.
Yes.
Did you find that confusing?
No, I found it rather stimulating. I must say, though, that from a critical age, from about 14 or 15, I did settle down.
Were you at boarding schools?
No, I was mostly at grammar schools.
Did you see a lot of theatre as a child? Were you taken on the holidays?
Yes, I remember seeing a lot of school plays. And then when I lived in Bromley in Kent, it was near enough to London to be able to commute up and see a lot of things. And I remember, you know, going to the Old Vic as a child and seeing astonishing things.
Were you in the school plays?
Yes. I suppose that's how it all began. One started off playing young maidens and young heroines and then progressed as the voice broke into the other sex. And I was lucky. I went to schools that had a good tradition of school plays.
You decided to join the National Youth Theatre. This was a sort of holiday job, wasn't it?
Yes, again, one of the virtues of living near London. Michael Croft had just then started this extraordinary company that was to grow into the National Youth Theatre. Then it was on a make-or-break thing. There was a production of Hamlet at the Queen's Theatre in the West End, in which I was involved.
What did you play?
I played, I think, one of those ambassadors, Volterman, that usually get...
usually get cut.
And that and all things, well, I do my duty, I think, is the line.
Yes.
And the idea worked, the youth theatre thrived, and it was a wonderful way to spend one's childhood. We did tours of Romeo and Juliet to Italy, we toured Holland. And the idea then and now is that, you know, the person playing Hamlet and the person sweeping the stage, it was just as important, and so on. The idea was this great group effort.
This cooperative.
Yes.
Had you at that time, as a teenager, made up your mind that that's what you wanted to do?
Oh, by no means, no.
When did that inspiration strike you?
I think at university, I knew that it was something that I had to do professionally. I had to get it out of my system, or I couldn't live with myself unless I'd put it to the test.
Mm-hmm. Second record, what's that?
God speaking. Laurence Olivier. Giving the Crispin Day speech from Henry V.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully a few bars of the William Walton music if we stay with the record long enough.
Did this film make a big impact on you?
I remember seeing it as a child in our local cinema and literally falling out of my seat with astonishment and pleasure, being totally thrilled. And I suppose it's one of those seminal influences, wanting to do what one saw up there.
We few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother, be he ne'er so base, and gentlemen in England now abed shall think themselves accursed they were not here, and hold their manhoods cheap, whiles any speaks that fought with us upon St. Crispin's Day!
The St. Crispin's Day speech, Laurence Olivier. What were you reading at Oxford?
English.
And you were mixed up not only with Ouds, with the Oxford University Dramatic Society, but also with the Experimental Theatre Company.
Oh, yes, indeed, and elsewhere with college plays and other ad hoc productions. And also having the opportunity to take these productions, you know, around the world. I remember taking a production of Romeo and Juliet to Israel, the cheapest way, which was on a Greek freighter, where I remember I had an air mattress sleeping on the deck that unfortunately was punctured, but not to the degree that I could actually fall asleep and it would lower me gently onto this hard deck and I'd sleep the night. I mean, it was a wonderfully, in retrospect, a wonderfully romantic way to go about it.
And in vacations, you used to work for the BBC, I believe.
Yes, I did indeed. I was in the property department at the TV centre in Lime Grove.
What shows did you work on? Do you remember?
Yes, I do. I remember picking up something and looking as though I was doing something useful and watching Tony Hancock live. And all kinds of interesting things were going off.
As long as you're carrying something, it means you're working.
Oh, yes, yes, exactly. It was a very lucrative time in many ways.
So when you came down from Oxford, did you go straight into the theatre?
Oh, immediately.
How did you set about it?
The last university show that I did, I asked some agents to come up from London, and I was signed on, and I got myself a job in Dundee in Scotland.
Very good rep.
Excellent, yes, but about as far from civilization as we know it as you could get at that point. But yes, you're right, a rep with a reputation.
What was it, weekly, fortnightly?
They'd just started a system of repertoire, which was an excellent way of doing things, like our national companies allowing productions to grow over a certain period. But I found I'd worked so hard, and I'd come straight from doing university exams straight into the theatre and knock myself out, but that by Christmas time, I was flagging, and I was given the pantomime off, and I went down to London. And while I was there, my new agent said, well, you should audition for the national companies, the National Theatre and the Royal Shakespeare Company.
You were accepted by both, I believe.
Yes, that's right.
An embarrassment of riches.
Well, yes, and one was faced with this dilemma that besets every actor's life, that of choice, that you see your life going in one direction or another. What do? You toss a coin or look up your stars in the paper or what? But some instinct made me go to the National Theatre to walk on, whereas, in fact, the Royal Shakespeare Company had offered me some good little parts.
Yeah. Your third record?
The third record is Mozart. And I remember hearing this record once by moonlight when I was very young. We were doing Romeo and Juliet down in Cornwall at the Minack Theatre. And someone had put this on and it floated out over the starry night. And it was so beautiful. It was the quintessence of beauty that I broke down and cried. And as an Englishman, I rarely do that, to be so moved. And the adagio from the clarinet concerto has always had that power to move me enormously.
Of the adagio from the Mozart clarinet concerto, Alfred Prince with the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra directed by Karl Böhm. So, the National Theatre, that was in Laurence Olivier's day, wasn't it?
Yes, indeed.
So you were treading the boards with the great man.
For me, yes, indeed. It was a consummation devoutly to be wished. I was quite thrilled to be a young actor in such distinguished company.
Were you given good part?
Yes.
Fairly soon?
In fact, the first play I worked with was a production of Much Ado About Nothing that Franco Zefferelli was directing. I met him in the canteen a couple of weeks into the production. He said, "Have you ever made films?" I said, "No." He said, "Would you like to?" I said, "Of course, it's everyone's dream." He said, "Well, maybe one day you should." In fact, a year later, he asked me to go and audition for him. He was doing a film of The Taming of the Shrew. Hmm. Meanwhile, in that year, I was very fortunate to play parts like in Trelawney of the Wells, the young Jew, and Albert Finney's brother in Armstrong's Last Good Night. The wonderful thing about The National is that besides the actual performing, there were classes in voice and movement and other technical accomplishments, which maybe I felt I'd, by not going to drama school, that I'd left out. And one was able to fill that in.
You also had the chance of working at Chichester, didn't you?
Yes, then the National Theatre had a summer season there. I understudied Derek Jacobi when he was in an extraordinary Peter Shaffer play called Black Comedy.
Oh, yes.
Which was more or less created at Chichester.
So then, in due course, you went off to play in The Taming of the Shrew for Zeffirelli. That was made in Italy, was it?
Yes.
And then later he engaged you for Romeo and Juliet.
Yes, he's a very persuasive man.
Did you need much persuading?
Not at all, no. The only thing was that I was contracted to do another film, luckily for Paramount. But Franco said, "You know, there's no problem. It's a very small part I'm offering you. It's not Romeo, for heaven's sake. It's 2 weeks' work." I think I was there 6 months of this absolutely enchanting summer spent filming in these wonderful Roman Tuscan hill towns.
He has a reputation as a perfectionist. Did you find him difficult to work with?
Not exactly difficult. Demanding, yes. And I love directors who direct and demand. But fundamentally, I think what works so well is that when Zeffirelli is working with Anglo-Saxon actors, is that they tend to damp down his slightly operatic excess. And at the same time, he's capable of bringing out something over and above the English reserve. But basically, Zeffirelli has a meticulous eye. I shall always remember going up to a little hill town to shoot a scene, and I found out that he'd sent someone on ahead to photograph every single person in this village, and he handpicked every single face. So it wasn't anything that happened by design. It was something, you know, very specific.
Yes, even his crowds chosen and grouped.
Oh, yes, absolutely, yes. And this is why I think his talent borders on genius. Mm-hmm.
Between the two Zeffirelli films, among others, you played in Joseph Losey's Accident. That was a great change of pace, wasn't it?
Well, yes. I mean, it was wonderful to play a contemporary part, and the pedigree of that film was quite impressive. Joseph Losey directing, Harold Pinter provided the script, and with people like Dirk Bogarde and Stanley Baker. Mm-hmm. My cup ranneth over during those times, and, well, it still does, but then it was lucky that one thing led to another. And I had a wonderful time.
Record number four we've got to.
Record number four is of Maria Callas singing Visi d'Arte from Puccini's Tosca.
Why?
For several reasons. I saw Callas giving this, her last performance as Tosca, in London at Covent Garden. Again, an event I shall never forget. I'm crazy about the human voice. I'm mad about her voice. And I think on a desert island, to have at your disposal the quintessence of beauty as distilled by the human voice will be quite wonderful.
Maria Callas singing Visi d'Arte from Tosca. Films have enabled you to do a lot of traveling, Michael. I remember seeing you quite recently on the box in a film you made some time ago for James Ivory, Guru. That was made in India, of course.
That's right, yes. And not just in Bombay, but all over India.
It was on that film that you met your wife, Patricia McCallum.
Well, actually, I'd met her before.
Had you?
We'd worked together, on Romeo and Juliet. And can you imagine? I mean, falling in love on that film. And then immediately afterwards, we went to India.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a pretty idyllic time there, too.
She was photographing Romeo and Juliet.
Yes, yes. And also on the Guru.
And on Guru, you sang.
Oh, that's mean. Well, I mean, sang in inverted commas.
You also played the sitar.
Yes, that I did do. In fact, I was so good. There's even a record of my sitting down with Ustad Vilayat Khan and playing. But you can't do it anymore because the fundamental thing you do if you play the sitar, you have to groove this hard groove in your finger,
yes,
which is the one indispensable.
So you really had to do some hard study on that film.
Yes,
to learn how to handle the instrument.
Yes, and I loved it.
Étranger, stranger, glücklich zu sehen, just wie enchanté. Happy to see you, bleibe reste stehen. Willkommen, bienvenue, welcome im cabaret, oh cabaret, to cabaret.
Other films I remember. Possibly your most celebrated performance, opposite Liza Minnelli in Cabaret.
Cabaret was certainly a success, and a worldwide success, and it seems to be holding up. And I think this is almost the danger. You get associated with a certain film, and I know that the image is very strong. It's certainly the same for Liza, too. I mean, her Cabaret performance was so deservedly successful. For myself, I've always tried to get away from that kind of image, having played a lot of polite, shy, introspective Englishmen, teachers. For a long time, I seemed to corner the market in them. And I've always tried to kind of ring the changes wherever possible.
How much of that film was made in Berlin?
About 3 weeks of it. But mostly it was made in Munich, in the studios there, and a little bit in Hamburg.
What good is sitting alone in your room? Come hear the music play. Life is a cabaret, old chum. Come to the cabaret. put down the knitting, the book and the broom. It's time for a holiday. Life is a cabaret, old chum. Come to the cabaret. Come taste the wine, come hear the band. Come blow your horn, start celebrating. Right this way, your table's waiting. What good's permitting some prophet of doom to wipe every smile away? Life is a cabaret, old chum. So come to the to have this girlfriend known as Elsie, with whom I shared four sordid rooms in Chelsea. She wasn't what you'd call a blushing flower. As a matter of fact, she rented by the hour. The day she died, the neighbors came to snicker. Well, that's what comes from too much pills and liquor. But when I saw her laid out like a queen, she was the happiest corpse I'd ever seen. I think of Elsie to this very day. I remember how she turned to me and said, what good is sitting all alone in your room? Come, hear the music play. Life is a cabaret, old chum. Come to the cabaret. And as for me, and as for me, I made my mind up back in Chelsea. When I go, I'm going like Elsie. Start by admitting from cradle to tomb, it isn't that long a stay. Life is a cabaret, old chum. It's only a cabaret, old chum. And I love a cabaret.
What next?
On one's desert island, one will think back to one's roots and to England, and one will need to laugh and to be silly and light-hearted occasionally. And there's one song I love. I mean, I thought of Noel Coward, but there's one song that makes me laugh every time I hear it, and an artist, too, that I admire very much. It's Jack Buchanan, and he's singing a song called Everything Stops for Tea.
Oh, the factories may be roaring with the boom-a-lacka, zoom-a-lacka, wee. But there isn't any roar when the clock strikes four. Everything stops for tea. Oh, a lawyer in a courtroom, in the middle of an alimony plea, has to stop and help him pour when the clock strikes four. Everything stops for tea.
Jack Buchanan singing Everything Stops for Tea from one of his films called Come Out of the Pantry. Playing D'Artagnan must have been fun in Three Musketeers.
It was. It was a great way to spend the summer. You know, both parts of the film took
Yes, both parts. It came out as Three Musketeers, and another bit of it as Four Musketeers. It had started out as one film, had it?
Well, it certainly started out as one big, enormous film, and with a necessary break in the middle. And at some point, the decision was made to turn them into two, which kind of paid off.
A very energetic role for you. You never stop jumping out of windows onto horses, leaping over windmills or whatever you're doing, but you were running the whole time.
I was amazingly fit at the end of that summer. I had muscles, you know, on top of muscles. It was extraordinary. Very sad. I saw the exact correlation between exercise and working out and the feeling of well-being. I wish I'd kept it up in a way.
You had a holiday after it instead.
Thank you.
What else? Conduct unbecoming. Back to India.
No, actually not.
Not?
No.
Fake.
Back to Teddington, in fact. It was. This was one of the last gasps of British Lion. It was filmed in the studio very quickly, because there had been plans, grandiose plans, to make this into a grand epic film shot in India. But there wasn't the money at the time, and this was done very quickly, in 4 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
With a second unit sent to pick up shots of the real stuff.
Baptism from you. And yet you come to me. Let it be so. We must fulfill all righteousness. Eternal Father, I hear your voice. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
You haven't done a lot of television. You were in the Forsyte saga. For a short while, weren't you?
Yes, briefly, as young Jolyon. I had my greatest success in Russia in the Forsyte saga.
Really?
I happened to be in Moscow at the film festival when the Forsyte saga was being shown.
Yes.
And all the episodes were being shown back to back, and I happened to be there just as my two episodes were being screened. And I was stopped by people in Red Square saying, Saga Forsyte? I was so lunatic.
And you've been doing a BBC television film. That's been shown quite recently.
Yes, making a film of a Rosamund Lehman novel called The Weather in the Streets. A wonderful piece of writing. And something I've enjoyed doing enormously. It's something the BBC do enormously well. A piece of quality, prestigious, well cast and well directed.
Another record.
Well, this one is a record of Glynis Johns singing Send in the Clowns from a Little Night Music. I've chosen this for several reasons, because it represents a lot of friends. Glynis is a friend. We worked together in a production of Ring Round the Moon. Hugh Wheeler, who wrote the book, was responsible for the book of a musical that I was in last year on Broadway. Hal Prince is an old, old friend of mine. In fact, we did a film together called Something for Everyone. And Steve Sondheim, again, is a New York friend. And I'd love to have the Broadway musical represented somewhere in this list. And I think this song, it makes me tingle. It's wonderful. All the elements work. It's delicious.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, you in midair. Send in the clowns. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps tearing around, one who can't move. Where are the clowns? Send in the clouds. Just when I'd stopped opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours, making my entrance again with my usual flair. sure of my lines. No one is there. Don't you love the farce? My fault, I fear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry, my dear. But where are the clowns? Quick, send in the clowns. Don't bother.
Glynis John singing Send in the Clowns from A Little Night Music. You mentioned having worked with Glynis in Ring Round the Moon. That was in Los Angeles, wasn't it?
Yes, at the Amundsen Theatre.
You've tried to, with all these films, to keep your theatre work going whenever you could.
Yes, I'd hate to lose touch. It's something not only that I enjoy doing, but yes. I think one needs to do, as I said.
And in all sorts of places. Serrano de Bergerac in New Mexico.
Yes, at Santa Fe.
And, well, you mentioned a New York musical. You've had the distinction of being in a New York musical that folded before it opened, which must be something to put in your memoirs.
Yes, but in fact it did preview for 3 weeks, and it didn't open. We ran out rather ignominiously. We ran out of money, or the producer did, and no one could raise the wherewithal to keep us going. And so no one ever sat in judgment over us. We weren't kind of decimated by the critics, because you know how the terrible thing there, things run for one night and they close. I mean, it's ghastly. And the tantalizing thing was that the last two performances, one suddenly saw how it could be with more time and some more money. But anyway, heard melodies are sweet, those unheard are sweeter.
What a pity you hadn't had it out on the road. And, of course, you played Hamlet.
Yes, I had one stab at The Gloomy Dane.
Which part of your career did that occur in? I know it was at Leatherhead.
At Leatherhead, yes. This was about in the early 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And I was asked to do it, in fact, last year in New York, and would have loved to have taken that offer up, and hope there will be a subsequent offer.
Yes.
Because I think to have had a decade between is interesting. One's perceptions are different, and I think the performance would be.
Record number 7.
Record number 7. Like the Prince of Wales and Clive James and the countless other people, I'm a huge, huge fan of Kirite Kanawa and of her recording of one of Strauss's last songs, Beim Schlafengehen.
Kirite Kanawa singing one of Richard Strauss's four last songs, Beim Schlafengehen.
You say it better than I do.
I don't
bow to your
No, I thought you said it
pronunciation.
Now, Michael, you recently made a film in which you played Robinson Crusoe. Where did you film that?
Just about everywhere you can think of where there's a desert island. It was a French epic, basically. The first time, the French had gone into co-production and making a bilingual version, because we've shot it in French and in English.
Mm.
It took 6 months, again, to make. Half of it was spent in Tunisia, on the island of Djerba. And then the other half, glorious, crazy half, was in the Caribbean, going from one island to the other, from Guadeloupe to Martinique to St. Lucia, Dominica, and a month on a tiny chip of an island called Union in the Grenadines. So I've gone through it, and even through the motions of, like, Robinson Crusoe being shipwrecked, having to make his own house, having to milk goats and all those things, so I've done it.
I don't have to ask you any more questions, except would you try to escape? Robinson Crusoe made a raft, didn't he?
Yes, oh yes, indeed. I can do that, too.
You can?
Oh, yes.
And navigate it?
Not so sure about that.
Oh, there's very little work to do there. You're nearly there.
I could drift along, I guess. I wanted to have something by the Beatles for sentimental reasons that, you know, in this, having lived through the 60s in London, somehow their music was the quintessence of that experience. And I thought of, you know, Sgt. Pepper and the Day in the Life of, and then I suddenly thought that what John Lennon sang in that wonderful song of his, Imagine, is so important, and the message is vital, that I'd love to have that as my last choice. He's an artist I admire. And I certainly admire what he's singing about.
Imagine there's no heaven.
John Lennon, Imagine. If you could take only one disc out of that eight you just played us, which would it be, Michael?
I'd have to put on a blindfold and stab at it blindly, but I think, on reflection, maybe the Mozart.
And you're allowed to take one luxury onto your island.
I'd love to have a telescope, a wonderful celestial telescope, because I think one would never get bored. It's one of those things I've been saving up to do, like gardening and golf, astronomy.
Right. And one book. You already have the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare.
I'd like any book, say, written on vellum. Again, this is going back to the experiences of playing Robinson Crusoe. But I'd go down to the ocean, I'd wash away the writing. I'd make my own little ink from squids or whatever. I can do all this. I'd sharpen my little quill, and I'd either keep a diary, or I'd sit down and write that play that one's always been talking about writing about, or that novel.
I'm so impressed by your expertise.
I mean, there's a whole gap between wish fulfillment and realization, of course.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael York, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Well, thank you so much for having me here.
Goodbye, everyone.